Matthew chapter 3, we're going to read verses 1. We'll just read the whole chapter 3, okay?
All right.
In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. And the same John had as his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle, or another word would be belt, around his loins. And his meat, or his food, that's King James language for food, was locusts and wild honey." Can you get a picture of this? John the Baptizer in the wilderness of Judea, and he's wearing camel's hair, he's got a leather belt, and he's eating locusts. Somebody tried to make the point one time, oh no, it couldn't have been locusts because, you know, the food of the Jews was kosher and they weren't allowed to eat insects. That's not true. They're allowed to eat locusts. He needed to go back and study, because there was also this word locust. Aaron and I looked that up to make sure. But that word locust is also, there was a carob bean that would grow on a tree, and so they were trying to say that that was the case. No, this brother was out there eating locusts, and he was eating locusts and wild honey, and he was clothed in camel's hair, and he was preaching a message of repentance. Now, let me just say this too. In the Gospel of Luke, it says that in the year that this happened, there were two high priests in Israel. Typically, they were only allowed to have one high priest a year. That was the Jewish law, for a certain period of time. But what happened was that Rome caused Caiaphas, who was the high priest that had been chosen, and removed him. And his son-in-law, Annas, took his place for a period of time. So they recognized still Caiaphas. And so what my point is that there were two high priests supposedly recognized at the time. But it says in the book of Luke that the word of the Lord came to John in the wilderness. So you see, a lot of times religious establishment is going on and it's moving about its business, but the reality of it is that the Spirit of God is bypassing religion. The Spirit of God is not paying attention oftentimes to established religion. The Spirit of God wants to make sure that the truth of the Word is being spoken, and it bypassed religion and it landed upon John the Baptist, whose father, by the way, we'll probably preach about that next week, whose father was actually of the priestly order of coming from Aaron and was burning incense whenever he was given a word by the angel that his wife would be pregnant for John the Baptist. Nevertheless, I just want to make the point that the Holy Ghost, he bypassed religion and he lit upon John the Baptist in the wilderness to preach the truth of the gospel. Amen. All right, so it says right here, it says in verse 5, "Then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan." You know what? While we're there, I like to teach too. And so I'm just going to draw a quick map for you, because I want you to understand what's going on here. That this is the Sea of Galilee. This is the Jordan River. And this is the Dead Sea. This area in between the two, this was the Mediterranean Sea right here. This area between the two, these two borders, was known as Israel. The Bible says, and Jerusalem was about right here. The Bible says that John the Baptist, he was baptizing somewhere right around in this area here at the Jordan River, that all of Jerusalem came to him, all of Judea, okay, and which is this whole southern portion of the nation. And then what was the other word it said? Verse 5. "Then went out unto him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan." That means that all this area here, people all over that heard of John the Baptist, that he was at the Jordan River, that he was baptizing, and that there was a baptism of repentance, began to flock to his ministry. Because what you need to understand is that at the time frame where we are in this story is that we have been in the Old Covenant or the Old Testament. Many times I try to teach this. I hope for the ones that come often that you don't ever get bored and realize that we have new people that come all the time. Chronologically, it's very important for us to understand the history of Israel. Because, see, whenever you grow up in South Louisiana, like I did, many times we just learn life based upon our own culture. You understand what I'm getting at? Like, in other words, hey man, I'm a South Louisiana boy, even though I moved to Singapore when I turned 10 in Singapore over there in Asia, and we lived in Texas, you know, they couldn't pronounce my last name Hebert. You know, all I knew was that we were Cajun, and that was how we lived our life, man. You know, look, we played Blu-ray, we eat gumbo, we do this, we got them listen, God ain't worried about all that. God's not thinking about Mardi Gras and Cajun. And, yeah, he's thinking about Cajuns. He's thinking about their souls and that it's good, and it's an eternal soul and that it's going to spend eternity somewhere. But God's plan is big and it all surrounds that area right there, Israel, because God's got a plan. So you see this right here? That's Israel. About. See that? That little black spot right there? That's Israel. It's much smaller than that on the map. I'm just trying to make a point. See all that right there? Everywhere where that black spot isn't, is not Israel. I got a point to make to you. God's got one plan. And it all started right there. Yeah. As a matter of fact, it started over here because there's an area called, there's a Tigris and the Euphrates River, and right here there was a place called Ur. And this is now ancient, this is now Iraq. God called a man out from Ur named Abraham, and he told him, hey, I'm going to make you a nation.
Yes.
I'm going to make a nation out of you. I want you to get out of your daddy's house. His father, according to the historian Josephus, was a maker of idols. So God told Abraham, I want you to get out of your father's house because your father and you and everybody else around this world, there's very few people that know me or understand me, and they're all worshiping false gods, fallen angels. That's what idols are. That's what statues represent. I don't care. They can say it represents this. They can say it represents that. I'm telling you right now, if you're not putting your eyes on Jesus, you're worshiping a false god. The word of God says in the Ten Commandments that you shall not make graven images and bow down unto them. And so the whole world doesn't even know God after the fall of man. And after the confusion of the languages at the Tower of Babel, God calls a man named Abraham out and he says, hey, I'm going to make a nation out of you. Come out of your father's house. And he said, and all nations of the earth are going to be blessed through your seed.
Hallelujah.
Now ultimately, fast forwarding through time, through thousands of years of human history, through thousands of years of biblical history, you got to just trust me, I read the book on this, that God gave Abraham a son named Isaac. It was a promised seed.
That's right.
Beautiful story that I really don't have time to get into, but it does say in Genesis 22 that Abraham, the father, laid wood upon the lad's back, the young boy who was a promised seed because the wife had been barren, but whenever she was 90 years old, she became pregnant. And then now the child's been born, and the Lord said, take your son, your only son, upon a mountain I will show you, and there you will sacrifice him unto me. And the word of God says he laid wood on the lad's back. And that boy walked up that hill just like Jesus did, carrying a wooden cross. I'm talking 2,000 years before Jesus was ever born. God didn't do this hidden in a closet somewhere. God has made himself known to mankind, but mankind and the world, they refuse to hear the truth of the gospel. They stiffen their neck, they harden their head, they deafen their ear. They don't want to hear the truth.
That's right.
And Isaac, hallelujah, that day the Lord provided a sacrifice on that mountain. It was called Mount Moriah. And from that place, Abraham said, this place is called Jehovah Jireh. God is my provider. Hallelujah. Yeah. Amen. Now the modern church, what they want to talk about, God gonna provide for my electric bill. God gonna provide for me to drive a BMW. God's like, come on somebody, help me out now. God blesses his people, but he provided a lamb that day. A sacrifice. So that you can enter covenant with God. So that where your sin separated you from his presence, he made a way for you. And you put your faith in the shed blood of that lamb. And now you're reunited with him. And now when you begin to submit to him, he can begin to pour blessings
That's
into your
right.
life.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Had a son named Isaac. Isaac had a son named Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons. Jacob's name was changed to Israel. I wish we could tell that story, but we don't have time.
Praise God.
God had to break him. Had to touch him in his hip. He limped. Changed his name to Israel. From deceiver to one who will rule with God. Come on, somebody. The first birth, you were born of Adam. You were born messed up. And we're all in the same boat. Don't look at me cross-eyed. We're all in the same boat. All born of Adam. All born in sin. And preacher ain't no better than you. Preacher got to come the same way. Got to put his faith in the shed blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Jacob had 12 sons, and his name was changed to Israel. And they became the 12 tribes of Israel.
Praise God.
Fourth son born to him was named Judah. Hundreds of years later, even thousands of years later, Jesus Mm-hmm. King David came from the tribe of Judah. Mm-hmm. And then 2,000 years later, about Jesus was born of the tribe of Judah. Yeah. Yeah. All Amen. Prophetic promises spoken throughout the years, never failing. God's continuing to be. You don't, listen, I don't mean this to be ugly, and I'm not saying it to you because you're in church today. But I'll tell the whole world if I could, and I tell them people when I look them in the eyeballs every time I get a chance. You don't have to believe it if you don't want to.
That's right.
You can ignore it. Mm-hmm. You can once again stiffen your neck, harden your head, and deafen your ears to the truth of the gospel if that's what you choose to do. God's moving forward with His plan. Amen. He wants you to come on board. He wants you to give your life to Him. He wants you to surrender your life to Him and to embrace His ways. Hallelujah. But you don't have to.
That's right.
Because see, He gave you a free will. Amen. He gave you a free will, and if you would rather choose instead to live your life the way you choose to live your life,
then go ahead.
Then go ahead.
That's right.
Right.
Because that's what he's going to let you. But he also has a way of knowing. Let me say this, because God's a whole lot more merciful than the preacher.
Yeah.
Well, I'm just saying, I mean, even look, the fact of the matter is I'm far from perfect, but the fact, you know, you understand what I'm getting at. We all got our own little personality flaws. And God knows how to love a whole lot better than I do.
Amen.
Amen.
And He knows how to get each and every one of us, including the preacher, mm-hmm. exactly where He needs to get us.
That's right.
In order to get us to bow our knee to Him.
Come on.
And
Amen.
To surrender our life to Him.
Amen.
So if you got a spot in your heart that you say, and nobody and everybody else around you, listen, this ain't even the message, but this is where the Lord wants me to go right now. Everybody else around you is looking at your life and saying, He says this, but look at that. Well, let me just tell you this. You learn how to deafen your ears to their voice, but to open your ears to
Amen.
His voice.
Amen.
Because listen to me. You might have a bad track record. Somebody was telling me the other day, man, I went to go get a job and they were bringing up my past. Everybody was like bringing up my past. And I said, well, that's who the old man is. Let him know. He said, no, you know what? It's time for me to shut up and to let the Lord do a work
Hallelujah.
In my life.
Hallelujah.
Great job.
And let it be proven. Amen?
Yeah.
And when you let the Lord do the work in your life and let it be proven, hallelujah. Then it gives some validity to the testimony,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
Nevertheless, right now we're just trying to talk about Israel.
Okay.
And we're talking about John the Baptist. Okay. And we're talking about the fact that that all the people went out to him, we're in verse 5, Jerusalem, Judea, and all the area round about Jordan. God started it all right there. Amen? And it says, and were baptized of him in the Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, now you may not know what that is, but those are two religious sects, Pharisees and Sadducees. You know how we got Congress, we got the House of I probably don't know my civics like I should, but we got in the House or in the Congress, we got both Republicans and Democrats, and we got two different parts of the parties. Well, Israel was a government that was built upon a theocracy, meaning that they were built upon God. And so essentially you could say the Pharisees and the Sadducees were kind of like the Democrats and the Republicans, but they were really, it was all religious in nature, but they were the religious leaders of the day, and they had to do also with governmental affairs, okay? And so it says that not only did all the people around there come unto him, but they showed up. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees come to his baptism. Look what he said to them. He said, you old generation of vipers. That wasn't very nice. That wasn't very seeker sensitive. That's a new Amen. Movement in the church, by the way. Seeker sensitive. In other words, we know people out there are seeking for a real God. So when they come in, we want to be real sweet to them.
Yeah.
And by the way, if nobody shook your hand this morning and this is one of your first times, I apologize. Because we should all learn when we see a new face to reach out and to say hello. So when any guests that we have, I want you to know we're so excited that y'all are here. And we Amen. Hope that you're willing to come back.
Amen. Amen.
I was ministering to somebody in the clinic the other day. And somehow something came up. And I said, oh, you go to church somewhere? She said, yeah, I used to go to this church, but everybody judged me. And I said, well, what does that mean? I mean, you know, I'm thinking it in my head. What do you mean they judged you? So they didn't like the way you look. Yeah, well, they wouldn't talk to me because of the way I look. Then my boyfriend had them big gauge things in his ear. And I'm saying, oh, so they're judging you based off your appearance. Mm-hmm. You know, well, that's not right.
No.
I mean, we don't judge people based off their appearance.
Amen.
People
Amen.
Look different.
That's right.
But whenever the Lord gets a hold of you, he'll start changing stuff.
Amen.
I'm telling you.
Amen.
And, and, so anyway, that's another story, but I just want you to know, if somebody comes in here with gauges in their ears, I hope that you love them and tell them that they're welcome in the church here. Praise God, because Lord knows I was a mess when I showed up in that church over there. But anyway, this is what John the Baptist says. See, he wasn't worried about how they looked outwardly, because they looked right outwardly, these vipers. They were all dressed up in their religious garb. By the way, just because the preacher wears a suit, you're welcome to wear shorts. You're welcome to wear jeans. I just want you to know that. You come to church comfortable. Amen?
Amen.
All right. So he wasn't worried about how they looked outwardly, but he said, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? You're full of religion. You're not right on the inside. He said, bring therefore fruits meet for repentance. What does that mean? Fruit is something that's visible that grows on a tree. You can see it. There are a lot of people that say that they're Christians, but the reality of it is that there's never been any real change in their life.
Right.
I'm not trying to say that true Christians don't ever struggle. Don't misunderstand me. We're not preaching sinless perfection.
Right.
But what I'm saying is that whenever the Holy Ghost moves into your heart, you can't just keep living in the old way you choose.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit deals with you, and He begins to produce fruit in your life. Amen?
Amen.
All right. And think not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father. You see, they were from this area here, this area of Jerusalem, and they became very spiritually proud.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen that happen in churches before. Well, we're of the Assemblies of God denomination, and we're the chosen few, you know, or whatever the case. And it's a spirit of religion that thinks that some denomination or some particular church has something right and everybody else has something wrong. No. Now I will say this, people have accused us of that. Oh, you're a cult.
Yeah.
You think you got the only right way. No, I'm telling you right here, the only right way is to keep faith in Jesus Christ and be crucified. If you got a problem with that, somebody said, oh, well, you got to move past the cross and move on to the Holy Spirit. Hold on a second. Time out. Did you read your Bible?
Amen.
I don't mean to be rude, but did you read your Bible?
Amen.
Because if you read your Bible, you would understand the Holy Spirit moves and operates through what Christ has done at the cross.
Yeah.
He doesn't work in that way. If you got some kind of spirit showing up in your midst and you're not preaching the cross or you're staying away from the cross and you think you're going to get there some other way, you might have another spirit showing up.
Uh-huh.
Oh, well, you got scripture for that?
Yeah.
Paul warned, there may be some that come preaching a Jesus, but it's another Jesus.
Right.
So they got Jesus in their story. And he's got a spirit connected to it.
Yeah.
But it's not the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Come on, somebody.
That's right.
Amen.
Preach it.
Lucifer, the fallen angel that Jesus called Satan, is a spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Don't think that he can't show up all nice and cuddly. The
Amen.
Apostle Paul said he transforms himself into an angel of light.
Right.
Yes. That's right.
Meaning he disguises himself.
Yes.
Yes.
And so we got to be careful. He said not only is it a different Jesus, it's a different spirit, but guess what? It's another gospel.
Uh-huh.
I ain't talking about David Koresh and Waco. I'm talking about filling up behind pulpits and Protestant churches all across America.
Uh-huh.
Strange fire.
That's
yes.
right.
Talking about we're going to get our blessing some other kind of way. And not really preaching the truth of the gospel. It's written. God wants it spoken the way that it's written.
Amen.
Lord, help us. Amen.
Amen.
And so you're not going to get the real Holy Spirit without it. Staying connected to Calvary.
That's right.
See, what are you talking about, preacher? Well, let me just say this. The cross, I'm not talking about a wooden beam, by the way.
Yeah.
Yes, it's a physical instrument of death. What I'm trying to say is spiritually what happened. When I say the word cross, I'm trying to say something was engaged in the spiritual realm. A victory was won in the spiritual realm.
Right.
When the sinless one died on a cross to pay the penalty for sinful man, something happened in the spiritual realm.
Yes.
And when you put, now what I'm talking about is the forces of evil were defeated because the sinless one paid the price. And when you take your faith, your free will that God gave you, and you put it there, and you keep it there. Oh, but I've been trying for 3 weeks, preacher. Good. Try for three more, brother. And hold on to Jesus. And let the Holy Ghost move in your life. And don't start adding stuff to you, Jesus. Come on, don't get me started again. Don't start adding stuff to you, Jesus. Oh, I gotta work this program, and I gotta do this. And listen to me. Don't add psychology to you, Jesus. If you want that preacher, he's down the road. We can't speak that stuff over here. Timmy, they'll try to tell you, oh, get you a list of scriptures. Listen, there's nothing wrong with quoting scripture. Please, don't misunderstand me. Well, I get myself in trouble. Should I not quote scripture? I love to quote scripture. Put the word of God in your heart.
Amen.
Read the word of God. Memorize the word of God. Study it and quote it and, you know, do everything you can with it. But when you start thinking your quoting of scripture is what gives you, now if you're quoting scripture to remind you that Jesus won you victory, hallelujah.
Amen.
If you're quoting scripture to remind you that you were an old man born like Adam, bound in sin, but when you put your faith in the Christ, hallelujah, the old man died and was buried, and the new man got resurrected anew, hallelujah. But don't start making a bunch of rules and regulations as though you quote the right thing, or you rebuke the right thing, or you confess the right thing. Listen, the Archangel Michael said he dare not bring a railing accusation against the evil one. The Word of God says in the book of Jude that Michael the Archangel and Satan himself were disputing over the body of Moses. We don't have time to get into all that. But it says that the Archangel Michael dare not bring an accusation against the liar. He said, the Lord rebuke thee, Satan.
That's right.
You need to put Jesus in the midst of your battle. Amen. When I say cross, that's what I mean. Hallelujah. A spiritual victory won in the heavenly realm. And when I keep my faith in what Jesus did for me at the cross, guess what happens? I was born guilty of Adam, but now a verdict of righteousness has been placed over my life. And now the Holy Spirit can move and operate in me. And he can bring me the victory that I need. I'm preaching before I even got to my message. Sat right here. And think not to say within yourselves, verse 9 of Matthew 3, we have Abraham to our father. They had become spiritually prideful, is the point I was making. I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. Verse 10, and now also the axe is laid unto the root. In other words, what you've been doing hadn't been right. We're about to put the axe to the root. There's a change taking place right here in this scene. You understand that? We said that earlier. Chronologically, we've been in the Old Testament. Now Jesus has shown up, the long-awaited one. You understand the prophets foretold he was coming for thousands of years. Now he became manifest in the flesh, and he has showed up, and now John the Baptist is preparing the way and preaching a message of repentance to prepare the people's hearts to receive the long-awaited Messiah. And John the Baptist is like, the axe is being laid to the root. There's a change. We're moving from the old covenant to the new covenant. Hallelujah. And he goes on to say right here, in verse 11, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Then cometh Jesus from Galilee, which is up north. That's the Sea of Galilee. So Jesus came down. Remember that little dot I put right there? That's where John the Baptist is baptizing. Jesus came down from the north where he was raised at Nazareth, and he comes down here from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized in him. Verse 14. But John forbid him, however you want to say it, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? See, John the Baptist had already been told by the Father, he heard the Father's voice, and said, whenever you see the Spirit light upon him, that's the one that I've sent.
Yeah.
That's the one y'all been waiting on. See, they've been waiting for thousands of years. Mm-hmm. You and I don't mean to be ugly, but you and I might wait every year. Hopefully we don't still do that, but because of our Cajun culture, we might have been waiting every year for Mardi Gras to show up. We might have been waiting every year for the family reunion
right.
to show up.
Right.
But for thousands of years, every year what the Jews waited for was for Passover to show up.
Yes.
We kill a lamb, we collect its blood, and the children want to know why. Why? Because God delivered us out of Egypt.
Yeah.
And for thousands of years, they've been waiting for this day, for Messiah to show up.
Amen.
And the Father spoke to John the Baptist's heart and said, when you see the Spirit light upon him like a dove, that's the one y'all been waiting on. Mm-hmm. He's Messiah. What does that mean? The anointed one. He's the hope of the world. You hear what I'm trying to tell you? When you look around and you see chaos, when you look around and you see famine, when you look around and you see separation, and you look around and you see pain, and you see death, and you see dying, and you see addiction, and you know what I'm talking about, because because each and every family in this place has been touched by it. When you look around and you see it, what you need to understand is that it's because of sin.
Yeah.
And it's the fact that sin has riddled humanity. But the light of the world, hallelujah, was Jesus. And he stepped down. God sent him to us. Amen. And he's preached the message. And he died on the cross. And now God's trying to get us all to believe it.
That's right.
And to come to it.
And come to it. Amen.
Verse 15, Jesus answered, he said unto him, suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. And then he suffered him, or he went along with him, is what it would mean. And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out the water. There wasn't no sprinkling right there. I just want to point that out to you. Jesus went under the water. And lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. So first thing I wanted to talk to you a little bit about was Old Testament Israel and baptism in the Old Testament of Israel, and how in Exodus chapter 24, I wanted to just make a point that there was some ordinances. There were some various ceremonial cleansings that took place in Old Testament Israel. Long before Jesus ever showed up, if you read the Old Testament, you see where God was telling them, if I spelled anything wrong, don't give me too hard of a time because I didn't really have time to check my grammar. But listen, God through the ages was preparing Israel, and there were ceremonial cleansings that took place, and all of them typified or were typological or were foreshadowings of Jesus and his work that would come thousands of years later. And so one of them in Exodus 24:8, it says, and Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people and said, behold, the blood of the covenant, that's the old covenant, which the Lord hath made with you concerning all these words. And so you can also turn with me to Hebrews chapter 9 real quick if you have your Bibles. If not, I'm going to read it to you. And in Hebrews chapter 9, the author explains to us a little bit about what we just read in Exodus. It says in Hebrews chapter 9 verse 19, for when Moses had spoken every precept to all the people according to the law, he took the blood of calves and of goats with water, so he made a mixture, and scarlet wool and hyssop, and sprinkled both the book and all the people, saying, this is the blood of the testament which God hath enjoined unto you. Moreover, he sprinkled with blood both the tabernacle and all the vessels of the ministry. This is the part I like. And almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without the shedding of blood is no remission. Now, what I need you to understand is, for a long time as a new Christian, I didn't really understand the salvation of the Old Testament Jew. Now I understand it very clearly. God's plan has always been the same. Faith in the blood is what brings righteousness. Faith in the sacrifice of the animal is what allows you to be right in the eyes of God. That's what the Old Testament sacrifice was all about, the shedding of blood. Now, in the Old Testament, it also tells us in Hebrews that the blood of bulls and goats could not remove sin. So every day at 9 and 3, there were sacrifices that were offered by the high priest that were telling of a future day when Jesus would come and die on the cross. Not only that, every time an Israelite sinned, he had to bring his own animal to the priest. And so all day long, there was the bleeding of sheep, and then the cutting of the throat, and then the shedding of blood. And it was all representing the day whenever Jesus would have to die on the cross. Some people say that's a gruesome religion that you belong to. It's not my fault. It's not God's fault. Mankind fell into sin. The word of God says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The word of God says it requires the shedding of blood in order to pay the payment for the penalty of sin. So the Old Testament sacrifice was that the animal was killed, the blood was collected, and according to the passage in Exodus 24, Moses made a mixture, and he used that mixture with water, and he sprinkled it on the people, and he sprinkled it on the instruments that were inside the tabernacle. And the only thing I wanted to tell you was that this was a type of cleansing that took place. Now you'll notice that it says sprinkling. All right, but once again, I also wanted to point out that there was a There was another thing that took place in Israel, and what that says is conversion of the proselyte. I made it a little too big. You can't see it too well at the bottom. What is a proselyte? Well, I'll put a definition right here. A proselyte is a convert from one religion to another. He changes his mindset. He comes to the realization that, you know what? No, there's a real God, and the ones that I've been following weren't right. And so what I need you to understand is that, you know, as you serve the Lord for a longer period of time, and as you let the Lord do a work in your heart, what's going to happen is that you're going to start feeling like you got to tell somebody about Jesus. Now, I got to tell you something. Whenever you first start to do that, people are going to look at you weird. And especially if you don't have the power of the Holy Spirit working behind you. But nevertheless, God said in the Word of God that you are the light of the world. You're supposed to be a light that's shining for Jesus. In the Old Testament, the Israelites were a light for God. The Word of God says in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 4 and 6, it talks about the fact that God gave them the law, His people the law, meaning the Bible. And what God said was is that whenever you come into the area that I'm giving you, when they see the law that I've given you, the Word, they're going to say, what other nation is there on the face of the earth like these Jewish people? What other nation is there on the face of the earth that is as close to their God as what these people are? God wanted Israel to be a testimony of light to the rest of the fallen world. And so a proselyte in the Old Testament was a person who had come into contact with the Jewish people and had realized, I've been worshiping devils. I've been a Grecian and I was over there worshiping Adonis. I was over there thinking that Hercules was something. I was over there worshiping Aphrodite or Diana. And now I realize I was worshiping the wrong God. If somebody from India happened to travel through on the Eastern Road to bring spices and they ran into a Jewish person, they might realize I've been worshiping Shiva, the great destroyer. And now I realize that the God of Israel is the one that I need to worship. And so they would become a convert, a proselyte. Now, in order for that to happen, some things had to happen. First of all, they had to be circumcised if they were a male. You had to mean business. Because that was the sign of their covenant. All right? Not only that, they had to bring a sacrifice. But they also had to be immersed in water. And I wanted to show you, I have a picture right here. This is called a mikvah. It's in Jerusalem. And this wasn't created for the Christian church. This was created for proselytes. For people from other nations, from Gentile nations. What you talking about, preacher? Everywhere on the globe, other than the black tape, is a Gentile nation. Everywhere on the globe, other than the black tape, represent nations that serve other gods other than the one who called Abraham out from Ur of the Chaldees and produced a nation for himself. And so every single one of them that would ever come to the realization that the God of Israel was the real God, he had to go down into the pool of that water. And really and truly, there wasn't anybody dunking him. What I read was they just walked straight down them steps. And what they would do is they'd walk straight down these steps and there was like a wall in the middle. And they'd walk around and they'd come right back up to where nobody touched them. There wasn't any part of their body that was left untouched by the water. And what it represented was that they were dying. It represented that they were making a choice to leave their pagan practices, to leave their pagan gods, and that they were going to die to that old way of life, and that they were now connecting themselves to the God of Israel, and that they went down into the water one way, and that they were coming up from the water another way. And so what I wanted you to see was that there was this proselyte or a conversion that would take place. Now, I'm not going to get you to turn there, but I will say this, that this is a picture of it's supposed to be a picture of Naaman, the leper.
Oh, yeah.
If you remember the story, I preached it a while back. It's a wonderful story.
Yeah.
In the Old Testament, 2 Kings chapter 5, there's a story of a man named Naaman. And he was an officer of the king of Syria. He was a mighty man of valor. He was very wealthy, but the Bible says, but he was a leper. I love whenever I see those little words. He got all this stuff going on, but the one little problem, he was a leper. And if you don't know what leprosy is, it's a problem.
Amen.
It's an infection of the skin and it causes it to eat away. And if you were a leper back in those days, you had to scream. They would be all covered up and they had to scream, unclean, unclean, when they're walking through the streets. You think that people pick on people in school nowadays. You ought to see what it would be like for a leper going to school. Having to scream, unclean, I'm unclean, don't touch me. How would you think you would feel about that? Kids used to call me fat when I was growing up. That was hurtful enough. But, you know, mom always said, that's because they're jealous of you, baby. That's what mom was supposed to say, right? You're so good looking back then, they're jealous of you. Thank you, mama, for being there for me. Nevertheless, you imagine being having to scream unclean. And what I'm trying to tell you is that Naaman had that one bad thing going for him. See, that represents our birth of Adam, unclean. But guess what? There was a young Jewish girl. She got caught up in a skirmish that happened, and she was taken away from Israel, and she was brought to Syria, and she just happened to be working for Naaman's wife.
Amen.
Oh, and look, she wasn't going to be quiet. She was a light in the midst of darkness. She said, oh, I wish that somebody get my master over to the prophet of Israel, because if they get him over there, I'm telling you, something would happen and make his skin all new again, because the prophet of Israel could get it done.
Amen.
Yes. Finally, one day they loaded Naaman up and they brought him over there with this big old entourage. And the next thing you know, the prophet says to him, he says, okay, you want to get clean? Then all you got to do is you got to go wash yourself in the Jordan River seven times. Seven is a number of completion and fulfillment. But he said, well, aren't the rivers of Syria much better than the Jordan River? See, nobody ever really likes to hear what the problem and the real solution is. Everybody's always looking for another solution. If you think the modern church is looking for another solution other than the finished work of Christ, then I'm telling you right now, you are being misled.
Yes. In the wrong church.
And I'm going to tell you something else. Just because they say the word cross don't mean they preach it. I don't have time to get into all that.
Right.
But listen to me. The next thing you know, he went away in a rage. Mm-hmm. But then his servants reasoned with him and said, come on, master. Basically, what's it going to hurt? The Word of God says he went into those waters of the Jordan River and he washed himself seven times, and the Bible says that his skin became like the skin of a child. And what I want you to know is that at least allegorically, what we're seeing is a new birth, being born again just like a babe into a new life. And that's a perfect example of a proselyte or a conversion, because look, he gave his heart to the Lord. He went back, he said, give me a couple mule loads worth of dirt so that when I go back over there to where I am, I won't put the dirt from Israel, and I'm going to worship the right God. Even if my king's going to worship a false god in his temple, I want a mound of dirt where I can worship the God of Israel, because he's the one that made my skin just like the skin of a newborn child. I wanted you to see that in the Old Testament we had both the sprinkling of cleansing, and we also had these baptisms of a conversion. And I wanted you to see that right there, to see the past of what was going on. Now, so we're talking about the ministry of John the Baptist. It was a baptism of repentance. So first I was talking to you about the introduction of the Old Testament and how baptism was used in the Old Testament. And now I want you to see the ministry of John the Baptist. First off, it was a ministry of repentance, a baptism of repentance. What did he say? He came baptizing and told them to repent. Now, what does the word repent literally mean? Well, it means to change the mind.
Yeah.
I mean, there's more to it than that. You're broken over where you've been, but you come to a realization that you've been wrong.
Yes, that's right.
You came to the realization that, you know what, it wasn't good enough just to try to be a good old boy.
Right.
How many people think that? I'm a good dude, man. I ain't never done this, I ain't never done that, I've never done that. So based on that, I ought to be good. No, you're not. You're born of Adam.
That's right.
I don't mean to be rude to you, sir. Ma'am, you're born of Adam. That's why you got to be born again. It's a baptism of repentance. Your mind has to line up with God's mind.
Amen. Yes.
Then it says that they confess their sins. The word confession in the Greek language is homologia. It means same. Logia is where we get the word speech. Or say. Say the same. Mm-hmm. So you don't just think the same, you say the same, and then hallelujah, when the change takes place, we're supposed to live the same. Amen?
Amen?
And so what I need you to know is a baptism of repentance, there has to be a turning around. You come to the realization that you hadn't been right, you hadn't been thinking right. You've been enculturated by the world that you've been living in. Naaman was thinking wrong. He thought that the rivers of Syria were better, they were more clean. It's not about how clean the river is, sir. It's about being obedient to the God of Israel that would one day give the prize, hallelujah. And it's come for unclean mankind anyway.
Yes.
the whole thing's unclean looking. Blood everywhere. It's a mess. So it was a baptism of repentance. And it was a baptism of conversion. I wanted you to see that in Matthew chapter 3. Where we were reading, it said, not only did he say repent, but he also said in verse 10, he said, and now also the axe is laid unto the root of the tree. It was a baptism of conversion. We're converting from the old covenant to the new covenant. The way you've been handling your business in the old ways isn't going to work anymore. You got to come over. See, John the Baptist isn't baptizing Gentiles. He isn't baptizing everybody on this globe that doesn't represent the little black mark. He's baptizing people that represent the black mark.
Yes.
He's baptizing the Jewish people. He's telling them that the one you've been waiting for is here. And now it's time to prepare your heart for him. Because the religious ways of the Pharisees and the Sadducees had muddied the water. It's real hard for people to find the real Jesus today because everybody's diluted the gospel and they're not preaching the truth because they're scared they're going to offend somebody and step on their toes. No, you got to tell the truth, preacher. It's not your gospel. They're not your people. You got to tell the truth and give them the opportunity, if they desire to change their mind, to confess with their mouth, to repent in their heart, and to give their life to Jesus. Now, a couple of things that I wanted to point out to you in the baptism of Jesus was that, first off, in verse 15, Jesus answered him. Remember, John the Baptist didn't want to baptize him. And Jesus said this. He said, thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. You know, I've been studying the Bible for a long time. And I've been around a lot of people that study the Bible. And there's a couple of people in this room that can tell you that I like to challenge people and I like to be challenged. I've lost probably friends over because they take me the wrong way. But people that know me and love me know, no, we're just trying to get to the bottom of stuff.
Amen.
And this has been a topic in my mind for a long time. Jesus' baptism, what did it really all mean? Jesus said we got to fulfill all righteousness. You remember the story, and I know that you that have been coming remember it quite well, the sons of Zebedee, also known as the sons of thunder, and what they did, they went to Jesus and they said, hey, who's going to get to sit on your right hand when you come into your kingdom? Remember that? And Jesus said, can you drink the cup that I'm going to drink?
Yeah.
Can you be baptized with the baptism that I will be baptized with? And then he said this, he said, you will be baptized with my baptism. But to tell you who's going to sit on my side in the kingdom to come, that's not mine right now. You're talking, this is my humanity. I'm here to be a servant to make right what the last Adam made wrong. That's the Father's doing. But when he talked about that baptism, what you need to understand is that Jesus is our forerunner. Amen? Right now, he's seated at the right hand of the Father. But before he was seated at the right hand of the Father, he resurrected from the tomb. And before he resurrected from the tomb, he died on a cross. Uh-huh. And before he died on a cross, he prayed in a garden. And before he prayed in a garden, he went down in the waters of Jordan to represent and to show us, hallelujah, death, burial, and resurrection. And he told the sons of Zebedee, you also will partake of my baptism. And when you and I put our faith in Christ, we also partake of the baptism of Jesus. Hallelujah. And I want to make sure that we make that clear before we get to the end of today's message. The first thing I want you to see is that Jesus' baptism was showing us, see, he's forerunning and he's showing us ahead of time what he's about to do for us. He's about to die for us, and the going into the waters representing a burial. But listen, not only that, what ends up happening is that, I'm ahead of myself on the slides, but look, not only that, it says he straightway came up out the water. And I already said it while I was reading, but what I want you to be aware of is this, is that it was a baptism of immersion. He went under the water. Tonight, if you're getting baptized, you're going under the water. And then he came up out the water. And then whenever he came up out the water, what happened? The heavens opened and the Spirit of God descended upon him. See, what I want you to know about being baptized with Jesus is this. is that when you're baptized with Jesus, you get connected to the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Jesus is going ahead of us and it's showing us the way. But whenever you get baptized and the old man dies in Christ, hallelujah, and the new man is resurrected, then now the Holy Spirit comes to live on the inside of you. I just want you to see how the Lord's showing us all of these things taking place in the baptism of Jesus and how your faith in Christ allows the same thing to happen to you. And then the last thing I wanted you to see in verse 17, it said, "Lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." Mm-hmm. I want you to know that when you give your heart to Christ, amen, when you give your heart to Christ, you become pleasing in the eyes of God.
Yes.
Amen.
You will never be pleasing in the eyes of God any other way.
Amen.
You will never do enough. You will never go to church enough. You will never read enough Bible. You will never pray enough. You will never do anything in your own strength to ever please the Lord other than to put your faith in the darling of heaven.
Yes.
He bankrupted heaven. Hallelujah, and allowed the eternal word to become flesh so that he might die in our stead. And when you put your faith in that, now you become one with him. And when you're one with him, the eyes of the Father now light upon the fact that you're in the Christ. And guess what? The same words can be spoken of. I'm well pleased. I'm well pleased with the Son. You're in the Son. And so now I'm well pleased with you. All right, point number three. What does it really all mean? Well, this is where we're going to close it up. Because, see, what I need you to understand is that what we're about to do out there in the water is only an outward symbolization or illustration of really what took place inwardly when you put faith in Christ. It's an illustration. It's a public profession. Jesus said to do it. Now, Paul said, I didn't come to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Because, see, sometimes people can get so caught up in water baptism that they miss the point. But Jesus said, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And listen to me, whenever we baptize, what you need to understand is that the old man that was born of Adam, he's about to go in the water and get buried.
Hallelujah.
And a new man is about to get resurrected. But that happened the first day you put faith in Jesus.
Yes.
How many people getting baptized today? Go ahead and raise your hand. Hallelujah. All right. Praise God. We're about to baptize some people.
Hallelujah.
Now listen to me. What I need you to understand, listen close. Everybody getting baptized today, listen to me close. You already been baptized.
Yeah. Amen.
If you raise your hand, you need to be born again. You understand that? If you raise your hand and you want to get baptized, that means that you have realized that you were a sinner because you were born of Adam and that you needed Jesus. And that Jesus died on the cross for your sin. And you put your faith in him. And when you did that, listen to me. People in my church that have been following me for a long time, they laugh at me. But don't ever laugh, because guess what? It's the gospel.
Yeah.
When you put your faith in Jesus, a miracle happened. A translation took place. Can I say it like this for the kids? You moved into a new house.
Yeah.
Amen.
You changed neighborhoods.
Yeah.
Amen.
See, you were born originally like your father Adam. He wasn't happy.
Right.
And Adam was guilty. So when you put your faith in Jesus, a miracle happened.
Yeah. Amen. Oh yeah.
You hear me? I'm talking about you got baptized. The Word of God says the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit took you. Here you were, born like Adam, born crooked and broken and all messed up. And when you put your faith in Jesus, when you said, yes, I need Jesus, you might not have known it, the preacher might not have told you, but when you did it on that day, at that moment, the Holy Spirit took you and he placed you, he baptized you into Christ. Spiritually speaking, a miracle happened already in the spiritual realm. You've already been baptized in him, and now you were placed in Christ, and in the mind of God, the old man that was born like Adam
has died.
Amen.
Rest
in peace, Adam. Has been born again. Now this already happened.
This already happened.
This happened to Matt back in 1986 or something like that. And I lived as a Christian for 12 years and didn't understand it. And so I kept falling and failing and falling and failing. And I never understood. Man, that old man's dead. You don't have to keep on living that way, because the Lord start believing that. Now, when we go get water baptized, we're going to simply, this is going to be illustrated.
Yeah, that's right.
You're going down into the waters of baptism. The old man's going to die, and a new man is going to be resurrected to newness of life.
Yeah,
now, what I do want you to know is this, and I'm going to read it to you real quick. There's a couple of little illustrations. The two different words, there's one bapto in the Greek. It means to dip, but it's more temporary. And then there's baptizo, and you immerse. But there's a nature change that takes place.
Amen.
There's three different examples I could give you. One is like cloth with dye. You baptizo the cloth into the dye. What happens when you pull the cloth out? It isn't the same. It's now taken on the nature of the dye. It's been changed.
Mm-hmm.
See, on that first day, the water can't do that to you.
Right.
You understand that? The water cannot do to you what I'm describing right now. Faith did that to you.
Amen.
And if you don't understand it, then guess what? We can learn it. But it's going to be continued faith that allows that nature that wants to rise up and take over to stay dead. You hear me? And so, but there's a nature change that takes place. So the cloth was changed, and guess what? There's another one that there was in the Odyssey. I don't know if y'all ever heard of that before, but the Homer's Triliad. Is that Iliad? Homer's Trilogy, the Iliad. Why am I even saying that? Because it's the same kind of Greek that the New Testament was written. And there's a word in there, it's baptizo, for a sword that was fire hot. And they baptizoed it into the water. And it became tempered. Its nature was changed. There was also a poem, not a poem, a recipe found by a Greek physician in 200 BC. And this is the clearest example of the two words. It says that baptizo is not to be confused with bapto. The clearest example that shows the meaning of baptizo is a text from a Greek poet and a physician named Nicander, who lived about 200 BC, and it's a recipe for making pickles. And it's helpful because it uses both words. Nicander said that in order to make a pickle, the vegetable should first be dipped or baptoed into boiling water and then baptizo into the vinegar solution. Both verbs concern the immersing of vegetables in a solution, but the first is temporary. The second, the act of baptizing the vegetable, produces a permanent change. When used in the New Testament, this word more often refers to our union and identification with Christ than to our water baptism. You understand what's going on here? See, this Greek scholar is trying to break it down for us. Whenever you put your faith in Jesus, something happened on the inside of you. The Holy Spirit moved in and He started changing things on the inside of you. When you were born the first time like Adam and you always felt like you wanted to do something wrong, when you really let Jesus in and the Holy Ghost moved in, He started changing things and causing things to be different. Amen?
Amen.
And we're about to temporarily get dipped, but the true nature change took place through faith. Amen?
Yes, sir.
Two quick scriptures and then I'm going to close. We want y'all to know that y'all are welcome to stay and eat with us, amen, and hang out. It says right here, Colossians 2, 12 and 13, that we were buried with Him in baptism, wherein also you are risen with Him through the faith of the operation of God, who hath raised Him from the dead, and you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh has He quickened or brought life together with Him, and He's forgiven you of all your trespasses. We're connected to Him in that first baptism of faith, and we're going to represent it in water. And it says right here in Romans chapter 6, know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus. He's not talking about water. He's talking about that baptism where the Holy Ghost put you in Jesus. He says that you were baptized into His death. It's really important that we understand as Christians that the old man born of Adam died in Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
That he was buried in Jesus. And that a new man was resurrected.